Welcome to my channel. Today's episode is all about Prada. In February of this year, Prada announced that Miuccia Prada would be adding Raf Simons as a co-creative director of Prada. I'm super excited about this collaboration, so I thought in this video I would share my five favorite Prada collections. For the most part, these five are the ones that I'm constantly searching for on eBay and Etsy and pining over the things that I should have gotten at the time, but I couldn't because I was broke. Either way, these are my top five, and I'm sticking to them for right now, and let's get into them. But before we start, let's do a little quick history lesson of Prada. So Prada is an Italian luxury house that was started actually almost 100 years ago. It was started by two brothers, Mario and Martino Prada. They opened up a small leather goods shop in Milan, Italy that they called Fratelli Prada. By 1919, they actually received a really high honor. It was named the official supplier of the House of Savoy. And by having that honor, they were able to incorporate the House of Savoy arms into their logo. So if you ever look at that little triangle Prada logo and you see that coat of arms, it is the House of Savoy coat of arms that they received in 1919. The roping is also from the House of Savoy. So by receiving that honor and title, they were able to use the House of Savoy coat of arms, which basically gave them this status symbol of, this is where the royals shop, you should shop here too. It was a form of 1919 influencing. This honor by the House of Savoy really gave Prada the ability to compete with other luxury brands such as Gucci and LV that were really doing amazing business at the time. So Mario Prada, being the worldly man of the early 1900s, held the views that women should not be involved in the family business. So he really never allowed any of the female family members to join the company. It was strictly Dickley. But unfortunately for him, his son had no interest in the business. So his daughter, Luisa Prada, took over. Luisa Prada ran Prada for almost 20 years. And then Luisa's daughter, Miuccia Prada, who we all know today to be the genius that is Prada, came on board. So Miuccia joined Prada in 1970. And by 1978, she actually took over the company from her mother. So the first thing Miuccia did when she started at Prada was she introduced nylon as a fabric, which was really unheard of before. Her grandfather, Mario Prada, was using nylon to have it as cover for steamer trunks or linings and things like that. It was an industrial fabric that was waterproof and really reliable, but not fashionable or luxurious by any means. So she introduced this waterproof nylon material, and she used it at first to make bags, and then later on, she introduced it in her ready-to-wear as well. What this really did was flip everything upside down in the luxury market. She came out with the Vela backpack that many of you probably might even have right now. If anything, you've definitely seen it. The backpack itself was functional and waterproof, but then yet again, it was stylish and fashionable. It was in vogue. It was being worn by every supermodel of the time. That backpack became the it bag of the 90s. She was introducing things that were just unheard of in the luxury market before. Prada didn't have huge logos or advertising budgets like other luxury brands that it was competing with. They used the more sleek, understated branding approach. What Miuccia really did was change the way we dressed in the 90s, because in the 80s, it was all about opulence, branding, showing off everything you've earned. And in the 90s, it really became where, as they say, money talks and wealth whispers. And if you wanted to show status, you started dressing really minimally, with no logos, understated, sleek. That was the look basically that Prada introduced to the world. And she did it by using a humble fabric, such as nylon. She made it cool to not have logos and to be subtle and not be over the top gaudy. She basically guided us to leave the era of the 80s opulence, and she drove us into the 90s minimalism of the time. Prada really became the antithesis of the 80s. With nylon, she basically became the status symbol of the 90s, as well as one of the most influential luxury houses of our time. And honestly, she's continued that sense. Miuccia Prada herself has really forced us to rethink what we think is beautiful, as well as the boundaries of good taste. Not only introducing us to a humble fabric such as nylon, she's also really done a great job of introducing us to her ugly chic aesthetic. She has been quoted as saying, "Ugly is attractive, ugly is exciting, Maybe because it's newer. She really changed the traditional conservative ideas of what luxury is and what fashion is. She's created clothes that really refuse to conform to perceived ideas about beauty or sex appeal. She really like took a different path, and she kind of just disagreed on what was beautiful with everybody. And for those reasons, she truly is my fashion hero. And I'm super excited to go over my top five favorite Prada collections. Fall 2015. This collection really included two of my favorite things in fashion, which is color and irony. And combined, you get Prada Fall 2015. Pastels for fall. And that's kind of unheard of. Who does that? Miuccia does it. And she does it oh so well. The whole runway show was set in different rooms, painted all pink or all green. It had a very kind of industrial, almost clinical feeling to it. When Miuccia was asked about the collection, she said, "Sweet but violent. I wanted impact." She had a few working titles for the show. One of them was Soft Pop. And I think that was just specifically referring to the beautiful color palette. The color palette is just mesmerizing. These ladylike pinks, sky blues mixed with grays, and this pukey green color that I think is probably the most beautiful pukey green color you will ever see. And Prada does green like no one does green. Her other working title was Variation on Beauty. Variation on Beauty is really Miuccia's fascination and exploration of real beauty versus fake beauty. And in this collection, she really set the question to herself, is something that is genetically modified still as beautiful as something that is just naturally that way? Is the fake beauty still as beautiful as natural beauty? When you really hear her exploration of beauty ideals in society, it really makes the collection even more special. There's definitely more meaning to it than just it's pretty. And honestly, with every Prada collection, there's always more meaning to it. That's what she does so well. We see shrunken trouser suits, three-button jackets, pants cropped at the ankle, sculptural baby doll dresses, cute little coats. She really touches on the cliches of femininity and what it really means to be a woman in today's society. That's really at the forefront of every collection that she does, I think. When you see all the garments that are walking down the runway, you really see them as these feminine ideals. The girls look perfect. They have bouffant hair, jewels in their hair, brooches, beautiful jackets. We see opera gloves. So we're seeing all these very traditional, very ladylike, feminine silhouettes going down the runway. All of this is giving us this fantasy of almost like she's ladylike, proper, conservative, some might even say. It reminds me of like Mad Men secretaries. It's a Nixon-era debutante. But then the fun part is the irony. For the most part, the fabric that is dominating in this collection is a double-faced jersey. It kind of looked like a neoprene when it was going down the runway, but it's really a double-faced jersey. In the most luscious colors, the fabric itself gives the silhouettes a more balloon-like feel and a more almost cartoon-like feel. So the irony of the fabrication compared to this debutante conservative girl really makes this collection so much fun. There was a lot of ostrich leather, but it was mainly printed. Plenty of tweeds, but there were plenty of printed tweeds as well. So the play on printing the actual fabrication as opposed to using the actual fabrication. Opera gloves, which we usually see in a very muted color, came in all kinds of candy colors. So the use of all these colors really brought in the sarcasm, the irony, and it was the juxtaposition to the debutante. So the irony really comes in these architectural silhouettes, the color palette, the fabrications, as well as the accessories. Gorgeous brooches that are made from plastic and not fine materials. And then rhinestone flower brooches on cocktail dresses. This doesn't feel like a collection that's dated in the 60s. It really feels like a forward-thinking, very much the Jetsons. I almost get the future. I get a spaceship kind of a feeling from it. So once again, she takes the familiar and she just twists it upside down. Spring 2013. So I'm not sure if this is an official name, but I am calling it the Japan Collection. And this collection is one of my holy grails that I still to this day will go on eBay, Etsy, The RealReal, and any other website I can come up with and search for shoes, dresses, or any accessory that I can get my hands on, because this to me is still one of the most beautiful Prada collections I have ever seen. This collection to me combines so many ideas in one, as of course Miuccia always does. I'm getting 60s very Courage vibes from it, but also 22nd century geisha, origami. But what's being folded in origami is Duchess satin. Just the thought of using origami on Duchess satin scares me, but the execution is so beautiful. It's really, all the dresses are like works of art, and mixed with opera coats and furs in spring. Garden bags, sporty, very athletic feeling too, but then you have these geisha shoes with these leather socks. Collection starts out very dark, and then it leads us to these pinks, and then it leads us to white. So it starts off in the darkness and it leads us to the light. When I say geisha in Japan, I would think it would be something very romantic. I'm thinking Galliano, Dior, but really these clothes are very structured in shape. Hence the Courage 60s vibes. And they're not romantic, they're almost stark. In her own words, for this collection, she sought to reconcile two oppositional characteristics of womanhood, toughness and the poetic part. I tried to mix them together because this is mainly what women have to deal with in reality. The clothes are the expression of this impossible dream. Womanhood and feminism, the roles that women play in society, is really something that Prada is constantly exploring. The juxtaposition between the feminine ideals of this collection come from the Japan inspiration, the 22nd century geisha, the origami. It's soft, it's feminine, it's beautiful. A lot of the garments have flower appliques. The fur stoles have floral inlays. All of it is so feminine and beautiful. But then you juxtapose it with this 60s Courage kind of very stark feeling, and it twists all of your ideas of femininity and beauty upside down again. What's executed so well, where it feels modern at the same time, this collection doesn't feel like an ode to the past of Japan. It really feels like an ode to Japan. The collection is just eye candy. It's mostly done in Duchess satin. I want the shoes, I want a dress. I've been stocking this for a very long time, and I hope soon I can make one of these complete looks my own. Spring 2011. I can tell you that Prada Spring 2011 is my favorite Prada collection ever. Miuccia calls this her minimal Baroque collection, as Bella's brave, bold, and obvious. And this is really the first time that Miuccia really takes that minimal aesthetic that she has really worked on for so many years and just says she's sick of it and she throws it out the window. There's so many references in this, from hospital scrubs that you can really see in the silhouettes, to 17th century cherubs, which can be found on prints with monkeys, as well as Josephine Baker. And her style is really evident when you see the makeup and the hair. There's really an ode to the 20s. This collection is also a little different for Prada because it is chock full of bright neon colors. This magnetic orange, Yves Klein blue, hot pink and black stripes. The color palette is just intoxicating. This collection is so colorful. It makes you want to have a wonderful tan and just be on vacation at all times. It is perfect. There's all these very Baroque prints mixed with bananas and stripes. Nothing makes sense, and in the end, it all really makes sense. There's striped sombreros, jungle prints, bananas, very pop color fur stoles. Yes, fur and spring again. The makeup, which was done by Pat McGrath, is very much of the silent movie era. Sunglasses have the Baroque line work on them. The models' hair also very much recalls Josephine Baker with the finger waves. The mixture of the Baroque with the cherubs, with the bananas, with the stripes, all of that. It almost seems like it should be very cartoonish, but it's not. It completely works. It's so sophisticated, actually. There's nothing cartoonish about this collection. Backstage, Miuccia said, "It's time to be bold." And really, that is what she delivered. A super bold collection that lets anybody wearing it walk into the world and just say, "I'm here." Fall 2017. So in this collection, Prada kind of gets political, but not really, because she's still a businesswoman and she's very smart and she wants to sell stuff. So not really, she doesn't get too political. She just kind of gets political, I guess, where it's kind of a fun theme. In the interview backstage, she says, "I don't want to be political, not officially political. When people ask that, I say, no, in my work, I'm not in the right position. I have to sneak it in." In the Vogue review, it's actually suggested that this might be an autobiography of Miuccia as a young girl in the 70s in Italy. It says, "A reflection on how far she, Miuccia Prada, has come since she was a student, a girl who was about to get wrapped up for a time in the left-wing Italian politics of the 70s. Get me a scarf and a gorgeous convertible. I want to be tied up in Italian politics in the 70s. Miuccia stated that the title for this collection was City of Women. All around the walls on the runway, there were these pretend movie posters and illustrated pinups of the 50s and 60s femme fatales. The setting itself looked kind of like teenage slash dorm room kind of a feel with these movie posters all over." She actually did commission original poster art from Robert E. McGinnis. McGinnis himself actually made 60s posters of Bond Girls and Barbarella. There is this kind of a nod to a young girl who is just getting to know herself and what she's into, including politically. She states that, "We have decided to look at the role women had in shaping a modern society, their political participation and social achievements." So this collection really is her political collection. So this collection kind of feels very 60s, maybe early 70s. We see these beautiful knits in these gorgeous colors with beading. The models are just flowing down the runway with these gorgeous pencil skirts with ostrich feathers in turquoise and coral colors. The color palette is just so delicious. Cool corduroy flares, the hand-knitted scarf, baker boy hats, patchwork leather and snakeskin coats. There are these magnificent tweed, very utilitarian coats that the models are wearing that are a great juxtaposition to the feathers and the angora and the beads. I guess this collection makes me think of Jane Fonda would be the person to describe what it makes me think of this collection. Someone who's very politically minded, wants to see change, but wants to do it in a very glamorous way with ostrich feathers on the hem of her skirt. That's Prada Fall 2017. Spring 2008, the last of my favorite Prada collections, the Fairy Collection, aka Tremble Blossom Collection. This is a collection where really it's all about fairies and romance and femininity and just being a girl. This collection really makes you think of the late 60s, early 70s, very Art Nouveau, very Biba, Aussie Clark. Think soft, feminine, young. Actually, I almost expected this to be a Miu Miu show. One of the overarching ideas of this show is fantasy and how fantasy to Miuccia is an expression of creativity in the modern world. In this collection, she really challenges herself because softness and femininity are not something that really comes naturally to her or that she gravitates to. And softness and femininity were really the overarching ideas of this collection. But that's what's so great about Miuccia as well, because she never stays inside her comfort zone. She's not a evolutionary designer, she's a revolutionary designer. The collection was all about these fairies, and I remember the ads were so gorgeous. The Fairy Collection just transformed me to the woods where I wanted to dress like this and just be this nymph creature of the woods. The fairies were featured on the bags, the dresses, pants, skirts, silk tops. All the fairy drawings were a collaboration between Prada and a Taiwanese designer, James Jean, who makes these hyper feminine fairy illustrations that look so effortless in this collection. They were printed on chiffons and organzas. The dresses had these balloon skirts. The models just float down the runway. This collection is really truly all about fantasy, and Miuccia's view that fantasy is an expression of creativity in the modern world. And we've come to an end. Those were my top five Prada collections. That was like Sophie's choice. That was really hard to pin down because there's too many good ones. Let me know in the comments what your favorite Prada collections were. And if you enjoyed this video, hit subscribe and I'll see you next time. Bye.